stress on the front cover opportunities going on this week. A couple things to lift up. This is Holy Week, and so Thursday we have our Thursday evening service. On Friday is the Way of the Cross. It starts at St. Alphonsus, and we will work our way through town and end up here at First Methodist. There are readings along the way. If you've not participated in the Way of the Cross, it is a very powerful piece. We encourage you to come be a part of that. That starts at noon on Friday, and then that evening is our Good Friday service. Sunday is Easter, and during the Sunday school hour, the kids will be having an Easter egg hunt, so we are praying for good weather outside. It might be raining inside, but the sun will shine out. That'd be good. Come be a part of that. Prayer requests are listed on the inside there. Christian sympathies with the Joe Oswald family, as well as Jewel was here.
She's right here.
I didn't move far enough forward. Jewel's husband Steve passed away this past week. So prayers with her and her family as they're going through that. Please do take a look at the other announcements. And if you have an announcement that's not in here, would you speak up? If not, then let us gather for worship. Let us come together. Let us open our hearts to our God and celebrate, for He is our Savior. Let us come to worship. One more thing before I go, because I would be amiss if I didn't. If you were all couldn't hear it earlier, you all missed out. Dr. Joel Brown is up here playing today, and we thank him for that. If you can't have Jerry, we prefer to have his teacher. If you don't know Joel, you're lost because he's a great guy. But thank you, and may you enjoy the music this day.
This is a day of joyous welcome, yet joy is tempered by impending doom.
Welcome Christ with wavy branches. We wait with Christ through hours of agony.
Our leader comes humbly riding a donkey. Blessed is the one who comes in God's name.
Jesus rides into the tumult of our times. People still oppose the way of love.
Yet love prevails in spite of opposition. Give thanks that God's steadfast love endures forever.
Open to us the gates of righteousness. Let us enter in the light God offers.
Remain standing and join in our hymn, number 278, Hosanna, Laud, Hosanna.
Thank you.
Most gracious God, we offer our thanks for the gift of your extravagant love, given us in your Son. With the crowds of old, let us shout our hosannas and wave our palm branches high, proclaiming Christ the King of our lives. Grant us the courage, O Lord, to follow you even to Jerusalem. As we travel with you, let us be mindful of the times when silence speaks volumes of care, when the words echo the passion of Christ's love. As we walk to Jerusalem, let it be with courage so that we might speak when the easiest way before us is to keep silent. Let our words sustain, nurture, comfort, console, and yes, even stir the complacent as we remember that Jesus came and turned the world upside down, and then put everything right. We offer our prayers in the name of the one whose cross we carry. Oh Lord, we offer our prayers for those that are listed in our bulletins, but also within our hearts. Lord, on this day, on a week of filled with all kinds of storms, we pray for those who have been affected by them. We specifically lift up to you those here in eastern Iowa whose lives have been turned upside down because of tornadoes. And we pray for those in the other parts of our nation who are the same. We also pray for those who this day are continuing to search for people who are lost and still missing. We pray for that town down in our southern part of our country that no longer seems to exist after the tornado went through. Lord, as the storms of our life can ravage us, we know that you are there and a steady anchor for us. On this day, when we praise your name, help us shout it all the louder as the storms are around us. We pray this in Christ's holy name as we pray the prayer in which he taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As we offer our prayers to our God, we also offer our offerings and our gifts. And so we invite our ushers to come forward for this morning's offering. And as they do collect their offering, we also receive an offering this day from the Iowa Wesleyan Choir and the Chancel Choir. I have to have fun with them somewhere. They're usually over here laughing at me. Now they're up front. They're making faces. So we invite them. Thank you.
May these offerings bring life-changing good news, both to those who give and to all who reach by the caring ministries of this church. May they help to restore relationships of trust among us and outpourings of generosity that echo your steadfast love around the world. May your saints be raised to new life, that cuts through the deceptions of society to bring a new order among us. O God, of all times and places. Amen. You may be seated. It's true. So I'm going to be reading from Matthew 26, 14 through 5. Then one of the 12, who was called Judas Iscariot, went to the chief priests and said, "What will you give me if I betray him to you?" They paid him 30 pieces of silver, and from that moment he began to look for an opportunity to betray him. On the first day of unleavened bread, the disciples came to Jesus saying, "Where do you want us to make the preparations for you to eat the Passover?" Well, he said, "Go into the city to a certain man and say to him, 'The teacher says my time is near. I will keep the Passover at your house with my disciples.'" So the disciples did as Jesus directed them, and they prepared the Passover meal. When it was evening, he took his place with the 12 disciples. And while they were eating, he said, "Truly I tell you, one of you will betray me." And they became greatly distressed, dipped his hand into the bowl, and with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written, to him, but woe to that one who the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for that one not to have been born. Judas, who betrayed him, said, "Surely not I, Rabbi." He replied, "You have said so." While they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you, for this is my blood, the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will never again drink of this fruit from the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." They went out to the Mount of Olives. Jesus said to them, "You will all fall away because of me this night, for it is written, 'I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered.' But after I am raised up, I will go ahead of you to Galilee." Peter said to him, "Even if all fall away because of you, I will never fall away." Jesus said to him, "Truly, I tell you, this very night, before the cock crows, you will deny me 3 times. Peter said to him, "Even though I must die with you, I will not deny you." And so said all the disciples. The word of the God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
I am really thankful that some of you think I'm as small as you think I am. That was awesome and a great little gift right there. So I have a question for y'all. Have you all ever said something that you thought was going to happen and then it didn't happen? Yeah? Or have you ever said that maybe if I tell the truth, I'm going to get in trouble? No? Yeah. Sometimes the truth hurts, doesn't it? But we still need to tell the truth, don't we? Today is Palm Sunday, and we're excited because we got to have a parade and wave palm branches. What happens on Thursday this week? No, that's next Sunday. What happens before Easter? Between waving those palm branches? That's today. And on Thursday, Jesus gets arrested. And on Friday, Jesus gets nailed to the cross, put into a tomb. That's not good, is it? And why did he do that? To take away the sins of the world, right? Now, here's the hard question. Have you ever sinned? Yeah. And that's a sad truth, isn't it? Right? But here is the joyous thing. What happens next Sunday?
Easter Sunday.
And why do we celebrate Easter Sunday? Why do we celebrate Sunday, every Sunday?
Because
Jesus is off the cross, they put him in the tomb. But was the tomb full on Easter? It's empty, wasn't it? And that's why we worship on Sunday. And so there's a truth that's a really good one, isn't it? Now here's one that's kind of hard, but you can change this truth. Are you ready? Have you told anybody about that? Don't you think we should? Yeah. Well, and I've got some books from Change a Child's Story for each and every one of them. And we had palm leaves today, right? And what color are those palms?
Green.
Green. You know what color they get when you dry it out?
Brown.
Kind of a tan color, don't they? Yeah. So I'm going to give each and every one of you one of these, okay? But before we do that, let's pray for it, shall we? Dear God.
Dear God.
We thank you.
Thank you.
That you love us.
And that you are the truth.
Thank you.
I was always told you're not supposed to follow children in dog acts. But now I have to follow the choir. Sorry, the sermon won't be that good. Truth hurts sometimes. This morning, I came in, and this morning for the 8 o'clock service, I get down there, and on the lectern down there is this little sticker. It's not really lit. I come upstairs, and there's one sitting on the pulpit, too. There's times in a pastor's ministry where you start to question certain things, and this is one of those, because the sign says, "Not today, Satan, this is God's day." So the question is this a reminder of a sermon I preached a while ago where someone's saying they have a different name for him? I know whose this is, and this is awesome because it's reminding me of a sermon I preached a few weeks back, and it had such meaning from the head that's made. If you'd like one, there's some in the back. I think this is awesome. Because it is. It's God's day. We come on this Sunday, this Palm Sunday, and some people might be questioning, why weren't we reading this scripture about Jesus' triumphal entry? Why are we reading this passage of scripture about Jesus being betrayed? What is going on? Well, I'll give you a little background. Once upon a time, hundreds of years ago, people came up with this thing called the lectionary. It basically lays out the Bible in a 3-year period, which in 3 years, you can pretty much cover the entire Bible. And thus, that is the lecture that we preach. There's your A, B, and C. They didn't like numbers. I don't know. Probably because they argued whether they should be Roman numerals or Greek numerals or whatever it was that they didn't let us. A, B, and C. And in that, they also, a number of years ago, not quite as long back as that, but a number of years ago, they began to realize people were coming to worship on Sunday, and they had Palm Sunday, and it's celebratory, excellent, and great. And then there's Easter, and it's celebratory, excellent, and great. And people didn't know what was going on during Holy Week. So Palm Sunday became Palm/Passion Sunday. And so we get parts of the Passion read sometimes during on Palm Sunday. And the part we have today, Jesus and the disciples are gathering together at the start of Passover, but prior to this, Judas had gone in and approached the religious leaders and said, what will you pay me for me to betray you? Now, the equivalence would be if Caitlin Clark had gone to somebody, some bookies, and said, how much will you pay me to throw the game? Now, if that happens, she never did that. That's just an illustration. I think her competitive nature stuff is something that is just outstanding. She is putting up numbers that have never been seen in men's or women's basketball. Wonderful to watch. Wonderful person to hear and listen to. But it's that equivalence, isn't it? You got Judas, who has been with Jesus his entire ministry, who comes out and says, what will you pay me to betray you? They said 30 pieces of silver, and he immediately began looking for a time in which he could do it. They're gathered for the supper, Passover, the high holy celebration, where the Jewish folk remember when this angel of death had passed over them, and they were released out of Egypt. But as they're celebrating it, Jesus says, one of you will betray me. And immediately the disciples start saying, surely not I, surely not I. And Jesus says, yes, one of you, and don't call me surely. Had to get Blair to laugh. Right? 8 o'clock service, they quite get that. But we have this notion with who's going to betray you? Who's going to betray you? And the answer gets to be as we continue on in the scripture where he says, eventually all of you will fall away because of me. Peter says, oh Lord, no matter what. what the others do, I won't, even if it leads to death, I won't do it. Jesus looks at him and says, before the cock crows three times, you will deny me. How many times have we denied Christ? How many times have we turned away and betrayed him? Maybe it was by the simple act of not speaking up. Maybe it was by not saying what we really believe. There's times where we say, you know, we need to stay silent because we don't want to offend someone. Now, we've got a group of folks in here, not all of you are Methodists, which is awesome. I just want to talk to Methodists for a moment because I only know this statistic. If you're not Methodist, go and look this up for your own faith background. But United Methodists, a study was done on how often a United Methodist invites someone to church over the course of 50 years. The answer is 2 to 3 times. 2 to 3 times you invite someone to church over the course of 50 years. If that's not a denial or a betrayal, I'm not sure what it is. We sit there and say, how do we get our church to grow? How do we make things happen? Invitations. As a pastor, I've broken that 2 to 3 times in 50 years. Broke that because I invite folks, you should come to worship. Well, you only say that because you're the pastor. Well, there is some credence to that. It's true. But I also think it's something you should do. I invite a lot of people here today, not to hear the pastor, but to hear the choir. I think they're great. I'm biased, I'll admit. Right? But I still invite folks to come. I invite folks, but they still say, you're the pastor. But here's this. If you invite them, and I will say, hey, I'll come pick you up, and you can sit with me. You have seats for me? I don't have to worry or wander around and worry that I might be sitting in someone's favorite spot. Now, I had a church, not this one, a different church where I was the pastor, where the story in the church and why they did not invite people to come to church was because they had invited some family to come. The family had come and they had sat near the front, but unfortunately, they had sat in this sweet, dear old lady's spot. And when she came in, she saw them there, hit them with her handbag and said, move. They left and never came back. I'm like, well, maybe someone should teach her that sweet little old ladies don't hit people with their purses and tell them to move. We laugh, but we can all think of someone who's like, oh, that might be. That same church, while I was pastoring there, we were in there in the office on a Tuesday, and somebody was saying, well, so-and-so is in worship on Sunday. And they kept asking, and I did one of these, and I went, they weren't there. And they're like, what were you doing? You were just looking at where people were sitting on Sunday. I said, yeah. How do you do that? I said, well, pretty much everybody sits primarily in the same spot. Just like in class, without assigned seats, they all still sit pretty much in the same spot. So I could pretty much go, yeah, they were there. Right? Why? Because so one of the parishioners decided to take it upon himself to begin sitting in other people's spots, so therefore they had to move just to play with the pastor. But in doing so, it also shook things up enough that you could invite people would come to worship, and they could sit anywhere, and nobody would hit them with the words. But we all have that betrayal somewhere, in some way. We all have fallen away at some time and walked away. And when it's pointed out, it hurts. And we tend to react in a few different ways. Sometimes when we're hurt, we respond with hurt. Sometimes when we're hurt, we withdraw and we don't return. And sometimes when we're hurt, we embrace our Christ who also hurts with us. And we respond in grace. That's only a third of the time, right? Now, that will get you in the Hall of Fame in baseball. Gotta put that out there for the Cubs fan. There's hope. Right? But it's one of those where most of the time, two-thirds of the time or more, we don't. Instead of sharing Christ with the world, we withdraw. And in that time, in that case, we don't live into this. Not today is sacred. This is God's day. Because when we aren't sharing Christ with the world, Christ isn't being shared. And if Christ isn't, something else is. Truth sometimes hurts. Anyone have a parent who would ask them how you want a band-aid taken off? Do you want it fast or slow? My response was, leave it alone until it falls off. Unfortunately, my grandmother was a nurse, and she said, that's not good for you. We need to take the band-aid off. Then just take it off. Well, do you want it fast or slow? It doesn't matter. It's going to hurt either way. Well, yeah, but if we take it off faster, it'll just sting for a little bit. Grandma, I got hairy arms. It's going to hurt all day. Right? Take it off slow. It's still going to hurt all day. Just, it's going to hurt. The truth sometimes hurts. But the truth also sets us free. Today, I'll try not to get you, but we'll see. Today, we're here and we've heard this awesome choir sing. Like we have on Palm Sunday for years upon years. This is Holy Week. And folks, this is a week of hurt. And this is a week of sorrow, a week of pain. Next Sunday is Easter. Mm-hmm. And as that wonderful saying goes, it's Friday, but Sunday's coming. Good Friday is here and we've heard. But Easter is coming and we know Christ is risen. Say is what they do, and they do it so well.
You might even say it is their calling. It is the gift that they have honed with practice and practice and a little bit more practice. And with that, they preach. So I'm going to let you guys finish the sermon.
Thank you. Thank you. Kohler and back.
Well, we'll be downstairs.
Okay, yeah. I'll see you downstairs.
And you have that thing from the designer.
Yes. Now, this I've got for you. Let's see. We need a pen. Let's go back to the calendar and back.